Okay, before we set out to apply Newton's laws, especially Newton's second law, to study dynamics, let us understand the great importance, the great role the quantity acceleration plays in connecting kinematics and dynamics together. Now, we know kinematics deals with the description of motion. We're looking for R, looking for V, and so forth. Of course, we're also looking for A. Right? We know where it is, we know how fast it moves, in what direction, whether it's accelerating or decelerating. In dynamics, we have the reason behind motion. We have the force. And we introduce other quantities, mass, and other things, as we study later. Those are, the force is the reason behind motion, and the M tells you just how much resistance the object has to the change in motion. So this is the reason behind motion. This is how it moves. How are these two subjects in mechanics related? Well, they have something in common, acceleration. You know, from F, I can get A, can't I? Right, through what? Through F equals ma, right? Newton's second law, okay? From F, I can find A. And once I find A, I can go ahead and find R, V, anything I want, as far as describing the motion is concerned. That is why A plays a central role in connecting the dynamics and kinematics, the two different branches of mechanics, together. We find A from F, and once we get A, we can find everything else we want to know as far as the motion is concerned. So, we're going to look at many examples concerning how we find acceleration of a system based on our knowledge of the forces, or to be exact, net external forces exerted on the system. We can find the acceleration from which we can also find everything else we want to know. Those are examples that we'll be studying from now on. Okay, now we're set to use Newton's second law to study problems in dynamics. Let us look at a set of procedures that we can largely follow for applying Newton's second law to solve problems. Now remember, we want to find the force, and from which we can find the acceleration. From acceleration, find everything else. Okay, so that's our goal. First thing first, we must define the so-called system. What is the system? Well, as we explained before, that is a particle, or it can be a collection of particles, to which I'm applying Newton's second law, F equals ma. You have to know, what is that object? What is the subject that you're applying the Newton's second law to? And that's called the system. Okay, now the system can be one object, could be part of an object, or could be more than one object. But so far, the only restriction we have is that every part of that system must have the same acceleration. Because if they don't have the same acceleration, part of the system moves with A, another one moves different A, then when I apply F equals ma, which A am I going to use, right? Okay, so that is the only restriction we have. Actually, later on, we're going to remove that restriction. We're going to look at what happens when you include different acceleration objects with different acceleration into the same system, but we're not doing that for this chapter yet. Okay, so let's define the system, and I will show you, using example, to show you how to define the system, how to choose a system. Now, once you identify the system, then you can figure out the forces exerted on this system. Okay, remember, only external forces matter, so we're going to use external forces on the system. And once you identify these forces, please draw what's called a free body diagram. What does free mean here? Free means it's isolated. Imagine it's isolated from the rest. You only take into consideration that object. Okay, you only draw that object. And that's called a free body diagram. On that free body diagram, you identify all the forces exerted on this object. Okay, let me give you an example. Suppose you have a smooth, you have a horizontal table, okay? And I have a box on the table. That box is my system, right? How would I draw a free body diagram? Well, the box isolated out, okay? That is the only object we study. And let's identify all the external forces on that box. Now remember, I have classified forces according to contact and non-contact. That is the most convenient way for me to classify forces. So let's look at the non-contact force first. Non-contact means this force can exert it on this box without even touching it. So what would that be in this case? Yeah, how about gravity? Okay, the gravitational force. Okay, there we go. That is Fg. That is m times g, right? If the mass of the object is m. That's one. That is the only non-contact force. Now, what about contact force? Contact force means that force can only be there if the object makes physical contact with the outside world. Now, the object is in contact with the outside world only through the bottom. Okay, it's in contact with the table. And therefore, there is a contact force between the force, between the box and the table. That force, of course, is a supporting force, pushing it up, right? That is supporting force, pushing it up. And that force turns out to be perpendicular to the contact surface. In other words, it's normal to the contact surface. That makes sense because, look, it's a horizontal table, right? You get a normal force, which is vertical because it's perpendicular or normal to the horizontal surface. And that force, of course, is only vertical. Otherwise, if there's a horizontal component and this thing's going to move by itself, it's going to accelerate by itself in a horizontal table. That doesn't make any sense, right? It's not going to stop accelerating by itself if you put it on a horizontal table. So that force is obviously vertical, which means perpendicular to the contact surface that is horizontal. So that force, I give it a name called a normal force, N. Here the term normal means perpendicular to the contact surface. Okay, these are the only two forces exerted, only two external forces exerted on that box. Now what about the force given by the box to the floor or to the table? Yeah, there is actually a reaction of that N. The box is actually pushing the table down. But do I care about that force when I want to study the motion of the box? No, the box is our system. The force given by the box to the table is not the force exerted on the box. Therefore, I'm not going to worry about it. Okay, these are only two forces. And that is a simple example of what's called free body diagram. Next, let's go to the next step. After you draw the free body diagram, the next thing you can do is choose a coordinate system. You know, we're dealing with all these vector forces, right? You got horizontal, vertical, or even three-dimensional cases. You don't want to deal with a three-dimensional case directly. Rather, you can use a coordinate system to turn these vector quantities into scalar quantities because the component of each vector is just a scalar. So if you choose a coordinate system, say XYZ coordinate, you can then think of Newton's second law as three separate scalar equations, one in the x direction, the other in the y direction, and the next one in the z direction. So that is why I want you to choose a coordinate system so that you can turn these vector quantities into components that are scalars. Okay, there are different choices of coordinate systems, and I will show you examples how to smartly choose a coordinate system that makes your calculation easier. All right, once you have the force, you have the coordinate system, then of course, f equals ma is broken down into three pieces in the xyz coordinate. Here is the x direction, y direction, and then z direction. In x direction, the net force, net external force in the x direction, the sum means it's, you know, adding all the forces up in the x direction, equals mass times the acceleration in the x direction. Okay, so why does the object move, accelerate in x direction? That is because there is a net external force exerted on it in the x direction. Same thing happens in the y direction. If you add all the net forces in the y direction, or the y component of the net force, you find that you will get the corresponding acceleration in the y direction. And same thing happens in the z direction. Okay, so you have three equations, up to three equations, if it's a three-dimensional motion. Sometimes these are enough for us to solve everything, to solve for the acceleration. And sometimes it's not. It is not enough. We then have to add what's called geometrical constraints. Let me give you an example. If an object moves in a circle, okay, it is forced to move in a circular orbit, that is a geometrical constraint, right? It tells you that the distance between this object and the center of the circle, which is a given point, is a constant, which is equal to the radius. That will be an additional thing, in addition to these dynamical equations, f equals ma, these are called geometrical constraints. Okay? Or if the object is restricted to move only in the x direction, then y is a constant, z is a constant, right? That's another example of geometrical constraint. So please add geometrical constraint, if any. Now, when you combine the dynamical equations and the geometrical constraints, there should be enough equations for you to solve for the acceleration. Isn't that what we want to do? We want to solve the acceleration? Okay, and once you get the acceleration, you can find V and R and everything, whatever you want. And the problem is essentially solved. Okay, now before we end the solution to this problem, let us not forget to check the validity of our solution. And it may not be easy to figure out whether this formula is right or wrong in general, but you can always look at some special cases. Okay, special cases. Say, what if I take the mass to equal to zero? What if I make it horizontal? Whatever, you know what I mean. Under these special circumstances, the solution is so clear that you know what it is without going through all the algebra. And then the question is, does your answer reduce to these expected special cases? When you say set the angle equal to zero or set the mass to be infinity, whatever, do you get the right answer back? If you do, that is a good testimony to the possibility that your answer could be right. Okay, it also helps you understand the answer better. So this is a set of procedures that we follow to solve problems with Newton's second law. And from now on, we're going to look at several examples that illustrate how to apply these procedures.